It is my absolute pleasure to welcome Dr. Brittany Peterson. Dr. Peterson grew up as an Air Force brat, her words, not mine, moving around the country with her family. She earned a BS in microbiology and an MS in biology from Western Illinois University, and then completed a PhD in entomology and evolutionary genetics at Purdue. And then she left the Midwest for a little while and was an NIH postdoc at the University of Arizona. And in 2018, she returned to the Midwest, joining the SIUE faculty and establishing the Bud Guts Lab. And so we are very excited to hear from her today. I will be taking questions at the end. If you could just hold until you get the mic so that we can make sure that we pick up audio. And then there will be a reception afterwards across the hall. So thank you so much, Dr. Peterson, for coming and joining us. I'm really excited to have you here.
Yeah, thanks so much, Liz. All right. So I entitled my talk, I was trying to get into the spooky vibes, right? We're getting into spooky season. I'm actually not going to talk about insect crypts at all. The insects we're going to talk about today don't have crypts. They have cecae, some of them, but not crypts. But I am going to talk to you about insect gut bacteria a lot. So that part of the title is not a false false advertisement. As Liz said, I'm Brit. And if you are social network inclined and want to follow my lab on Instagram, we do some cool things. We just posted our fall 2023 lab photo yesterday. So good stuff over there. Where I always like to start is to highlight the scientists that do the science, because without the scientists, the science doesn't get done. And at SIUE, we're primarily undergraduate institutions. So most of the researchers that you see on this slide are undergraduates. There are a couple of master's students, and I'll be highlighting the students as we go along in reference to their work. This is our current lab, and then I'm gonna be highlighting the work of all of these alumni across the bottom, some brilliant ladies. So we've had a very female bias in my lab. And then I would be remiss not to also acknowledge some of my collaborators. We're gonna talk a little bit about the Behavioral Research Plasticity Institute. So that those are my collaborators. And we've got a collaborator from biomedical sciences from right here at WashU. So he's picking up his daughter, otherwise he would be here. the other thing that doesn't happen, science doesn't happen without, is funding. And so I'll also highlight some of the funding agencies that have contributed to this work. So the graduate school at SIUE, Illinois Academy of Sciences, Sigma Xi, these are all graduate funding. This is all funding that my graduate students have gotten. And then on the left is stuff that I actually applied for and got. So we have a undergraduate research project that funds undergraduate researchers in the lab. My startup, you know, still an assistant professor. Put that dossier in though, so we're good. We're on the other side of that. And then an NSF BII, so it's a Biological Integration Institute grant that funds the Behavioral Plasticity Research Institute. So I want to make sure that we're kind of all on the same page before we dive into three vignettes from my lab. So the first thing I want to do is make sure we're on the same page about how we define symbiosis. And to me, symbiosis is broadly defined as a long-term close association of two or more species. And something that I have to kind of drive home in my microbiology class is we often synonymize symbiosis and mutualism. And I really want to encourage folks to think about symbiosis as a spectrum with mutualism clearly included at one end of that spectrum, and then antagonistic relationships kind of at the other end of that spectrum. And really most of the things that we're looking at are somewhere in between along this continuum. And importantly, they're context dependent and dynamic throughout the relationship and interaction between organisms. So while I may call something a pathogen, just remember it's context dependent and those relationships are dynamic. And I titled this Tales from the Crypt. We are gonna talk about gut symbionts today. And I think gut symbionts are super interesting. Not to knock anyone who studies intracellular symbiosis, that is also super interesting. Like we love to talk about endosymbiotic theory in my class. It's one of my soapbox moments. But I think gut symbiosis is really interesting to study because it has different constraints on it than something that's intracellular. So they are extracellular, meaning that they're often relying on attachment or specialized structures of the host's anatomy to persist. They can exist in biofilms with other mutualists or synergists or commensals or pathogens. So those biofilms are complex and dynamic. They can be acquired in a lot of ways. We typically think about intracellular symbionts being acquired vertically from mother to offspring, but gut symbionts can be dynamic in the way that they're acquired. So a lot of commensals are acquired environmentally and can be actually quite important and have phenotypic effects on their host, even though they're not obligately associated. And then finally, we know, especially in insects, that the life history of that insect changes throughout its development, what it feeds on, where it lives. And so that environmental context can also shape the microbes it comes into contact with. So I think all of these things make studying gut symbiosis really interesting, but distinct from intracellular symbioses. And so just to plug, laying lots of foundation here, why study insect symbioses in particular? One, some of the very first symbioses, gut symbioses at least, that we understood were gut symbioses in termites. And we have a lot of evidence, it's kind of like where we liked symbiosis to stay in terms of gut symbiosis, that those bacteria in the gut must be helping digest, maybe they're supplementing nutrition, but we like to kind of compartmentalize them as they're in the digestive tract, so they're just important for digestion. And then we realized that, that's not entirely true. We see again and again examples where organisms that colonize the gut can have ramifications across the physiology of the host, including protective symbioses. And then we can also exploit those symbioses. We can hedge our bets and use antagonistic microbes to cause insect host death, like this grasshopper succumbed to. So things like biopesticides are an application that we might be able to develop out of studying these types of systems. So broadly, you see, I started off talking about the spectrum. I'm really interested in all of the facets of these interactions. And so I basically work to characterize community composition, the capabilities of these communities physiologically, and the potential applications for both the bacteria and the joint impact on both host ecology and evolution. So super broad. This allows me to collaborate with my undergraduate researchers on just about anything that they're interested in. If they have seen something, they collected some insects they think are cool and want to ask a cool research question about it, it gives us that flexibility. So the question we're going to kind of explore today is really about how do bacterial associates mediate interactions between their hosts and other components of the environment. And so in this diagram, you know, we've got the back and forth between the host and the microbes, but you also have a myriad of biotic and abiotic interactions that both parties are going to be influenced by. And so we're going to talk about several of those today. And we're going to focus on a couple of systems from my lab. These are the current insect models that we're using. I'm only going to talk about two of them today. But if you're interested in kissing bugs or Mormon crickets, I'm happy to chat more with you about those projects. They're just less developed. So we're still kind of getting our feet on the ground versus the locusts and termites that we've been working on a little bit more. So if we go back to our overarching model, we're going to kind of cherry pick three different types of interactions that I think symbionts, or I have evidence that symbionts play a role in terms of how their host navigates the world. So those three are going to be pathogens. So we've got a host, commensal or beneficial microbes, and potential pathogens. Then we have conspecifics. So how microbe community composition influences behavior and conspecific interactions. And then finally, pesticides. So an abiotic factor that we have a lot of interest in the field of entomology, because a lot of times we are trying to kill our host insect. So we're going to start here with our pathogen example. And this funding, this work was funded by these funding sources. I'm just going to pop them up along the way so that they get their credit. So the first thing that you need to know about termites, because this story is about termites, is that they are actually really good at keeping their colonies clean, and they tend not to succumb to pathogens as a rule. We've had like half a century of biocontrol failure in termites where it works in the lab. We try to deploy it in a field-like setting and it fails miserably. And part of that is due to hygienic behaviors and things like aloe and auto-grooming. When we perturb their gut, we can see some of the mortality that we might expect to see in a typical pathogen-host interaction. And those things can also be exaggerated by perturbing the gut with things like pesticides. So this Sinanal paper shows that an insecticide and both fungal and bacterial pathogens synergize, resulting in more host mortality than you get from any of those treatments alone. So this is a termite that has succumbed, or several termites that have succumbed to Serratia marcescens, which is this brilliant red opportunistic bacterial pathogen that's super common in insects. And so even though we have all of these anecdotes about how biocontrol doesn't work in termites, we have kind of the partner to it where it's like, in the lab, we can make this happen. And can we understand how symbionts are playing a role in this? So one thing that this figure doesn't really capture and is actually the supplement of this paper is that when we treated these termites with insecticide, we actually saw that their normal gut flora were significantly perturbed. And so we correlated that relationship to higher mortality from opportunistic pathogens. And that trend has actually kind of emerged from the termite literature as something that's kind of exciting, expanding termite symbionts' role in termite biology from just kind of that digestive niche to really thinking about how the organisms, not just bacteria, but protists and other things in the gut, are contributing to pathogen protection. And so we had been kind of working on this for a little while, trying to understand why this happens. And in particular, why all of these examples are fungal pathogens. We had no evidence of how bacterial pathogens were interacting in this system. And so that leads me to my previous graduate student, Jordan. And she was really interested in understanding bacteria-bacteria interactions from the termite gut and understanding how they interact. And she had a hypothesis that there are symbionts in the termite gut that outcompete pathogens for resources, and that is a proxy to get protection. And so she did this nice little experiment where she isolated a bunch of bacteria from the termite gut and then pitted them against our brilliant red Serratia marcescens in this 50-50 gauntlet, basically. Mixed them one-to-one, but based on cell count, and then let them grow. And she measured them at a bunch of time points, and this one was the one that had the least variation. So we went with that, measured them all in triplicate. And what she found was that some termite symbionts seem to outcompete that Serratia marcescens. And so I like this. This is a very qualitative picture, but the red, again, is our pathogen, and the white, in this case, are symbionts. And all of these, with the exception of this bottom figure, are 50-50 cocktails. And so you can see that's what you would expect if it was pathogen alone. That top left looks like pathogen alone. This top right kind of looks like some kind of intermediate, maybe a 50-50 mix like we might expect. And then these other two, they're all white. There are a couple of red colonies on there, but they're very few and far between. And so of course, Jordan counted, she, you know, grad students have to do all kinds of horrible things. And so she counted lots and lots of petri dishes and found that in fact, some of these symbionts outcompeted the pathogen 100-1. And so she was really excited about this and wanted to try to identify the mechanism that was going on here. So she repeated the experiment, but at shorter time points and did protein extractions from that secretion from the supernatant. Paula did the supernatant, ran some protein profiles and sent them off for mass spec analysis. So we got one band that was kind of interesting. And when she pulled up all of the results, we kind of saw some patterns. So the first thing we saw was some chaperones. Okay, that's maybe not that exciting. We're in a stressed out situation. Not so surprising. We also have some things that are associated with pathogenesis. We might expect those to be upregulated in a relationship where there's a pathogen involved. Then we've got a bunch of things associated with outer membrane lipoproteins. And Jordan, being the diligent grad student that she was, combed the literature and came up with a hypothesis about what this mechanism could be. And she landed on type 6 secretion systems. She found that in the mammalian systems, type 6 secretion systems were really important for maintaining gut homeostasis. And so she hypothesized that this was a mechanism that her symbiont could be using to outcompete this pathogen. So of course, we had to do some genomics and find out, well, is it a type 6 secretion system? And it is. In fact, our type 6 secretion system positive termite is also a Serratia. It's just not Serratia marcescens. So now we have congeneric competition, which makes this, as an evolutionary biologist, even more exciting. And it has not one, but two complete type 6 secretion systems, which I found out is relatively common in some of these gram-negative bacteria, particularly Serratia. So on the right here, I have kind of a color-coded diagram of the apparatus. So the type 6 secretion system is a protein complex that spans both membranes of a gram-negative bacterium cell wall. And it has this tube structure that allows it to secrete things outside of itself, and actually most of the time is secreting it directly into a target cell. So its intention is antagonism. And we think it has evolutionary relationships or history origin with bacteriophages, which makes sense. So these two kind of diagrams are showing you the two loci in each of the Serratia bacteria. So the top one, we're calling our native Serratia. That's our symbiont that we isolated, that's the white one. And then we have our pathogenic Serratia, Serratia marcescens, that's our red one. And what I hope you can tell from this is in both of these organisms, the top locus is architecturally very similar. The genes are about the same length, they're in the same order, about the same size. And we actually found out that this is the type of type 6 secretion system that Serratia typically have. So was revolutionary to us because we had never studied secretion systems before, but shouldn't have surprised us if we knew what we were doing. On the other hand, the bottom cluster of genes are oriented in a slightly different way that would suggest that they're not as closely related. And so we decided to focus in on what we're calling the second type 6 secretion system in our native Serratia. And we'll come back to that in just a minute. We're interested to know if the differences there are actually why we see these differences in competition assays. But what's really cool about the type 6 secretion system is that it secretes things, and those things are typically toxins. And so we're always very excited about novel toxins. And so we did some, you know, rough bioinformatic analysis and found, yep, of course there are. There are, in fact, 22 putative toxins spread across the genome. That was also my naivety. I thought they would all be located in that cluster with the protein coding genes for the actual apparatus. Not so. They're all over the genome. And most of the time you'll see that they're in tandem. And that's because we think they're often toxin, antitoxin, right, in tandem in the genome. So we're gonna keep with this trend for a little while. We're interested in knowing, okay, so if it's the type 6 secretion system, we should have some bactericidal toxins here. And so that brings up Camilla and Alyssa, and they decided, two undergrads at the time, they decided they were going to start screening these toxins to see if they were actually bactericidal. So they came up with a protocol that I think is pretty slick. So we've got a vector, and on this vector, we have a chlorampheniprole resistance marker. So we have a way to select for bacteria that have it. We also have an inducible promoter. So in this case, it's arabinose inducible. So when arabinose is there, whatever gene follows that will get turned on. And when there's no arabinose, that gene will not be turned on. So it's a nice way to be able to control the on-off switch on our toxin. So we put our toxin, putative toxin, right downstream of that promoter and transform it into E. coli. Then we take those E. coli and grow them up with and without chlorampheniclol, with chlorampheniclol, with and without arabinose. So in the left situation, the toxin gene shouldn't be on, so everybody should live. In the arabinose present situation, if it dies, it might be toxic. And I spoiled myself, that was up there. We also included T4, which is a previously characterized type 6 secretion system effector, well known, and an empty vector as a negative control. And so this is actually what it looked like. It was all liquid culture. They tried a lot of different assays to try to get this to work. So this is what we actually ended up with. And what you're going to see is the difference in growth between the glucose-containing media and the arabinose and glucose-containing media. So we would expect that if it's non-toxic, that ratio would be 1. They should grow just as well with or without the toxin being on. And so what you can see, I'll orient you to this graph from left to right. The bottom, the x-axis, are the different genes that we screened, with the empty vector being in red and our positive control T4 being in white. And the y-axis is that ratio of arabinose to glucose growth. And so right at 1, you can see our empty vector is right about there. Several of our other putative effectors are also there, but we have 3. 729, 743, and 2099, that all are significantly different than the empty vector, but also significantly different from 1, which we would expect if it was toxic. So that's exciting. We have some putative toxins. So half of the ones that we screened were potentially bactericidal, which, if you remember, I told you that they should be paired toxin and antitoxin. So about 50% of the ones that we screened should be toxins. The other 50% should be antitoxins. So we totally chose at random because they're the ones that the transformations worked at when the students were working on it. But I thought that was kind of poetic. So we still have a bunch more effectors to screen. And that's actually Alyssa's master's project. The first chapter of her master's thesis is getting hopefully the rest of those into E. coli. Some of them are kind of big, which makes me think that they're actually more than just the toxin. So we might have to do some more bioinformatics to narrow that down. So I also showed you that there were 2 type 6 secretion system loci, and we hypothesized that that second one that was different than anything the pathogen had might be explaining this outcompete phenotype. And so Emma worked to develop a type 6 secretion system 2 mutant. So what she did was took the HCP gene and mutagenized it using homologous recombination. So basically, she took a plasmid and dumped a resistance marker into the middle of that gene. So now we have a way to screen the bacteria that are resistant, but also because bacteria can't splice, they can't recover the gene. So they're not going to be able to synthesize that mRNA. They're not going to be able to make that protein. So you can see HCP represented in orange is the barrel of the type 6 secretion system. So without it, we can assume that it's going to be disrupted and we shouldn't see secretion from that locus. And so she basically developed this type 6 secretion system 2 mutant and then repeated that same experiment that Jordan did way back when to see if we had a difference in that outcompete phenotype. She actually also made HCP1 mutants just to test, and we had planned on a double mutant, but I don't know if you've made knockout bacteria in non-model systems. It is not for the faint of heart. And so the fact that a master's student did that in 2 years and made 2 of them, I was pretty happy. So across the x-axis here, we have our wild type. Remember I told you that it outcompetes 100-to-1. Then we have our HCP1, so that's the HCP that the competitor also has. And then our HCP2, which is the one we were hypothesizing was actually responsible for the outcompete phenotype. And the y-axis here is just red to white, which is pathogen to symbiont. And what you can see is that both mutating either of the type 6 secretion systems actually rescues the phenotype a little bit. So the pathogen is able to kind of hold its own. But if you look at that HTP2 mutant, it's almost back to one, which is what we would expect. That means it's at a 1-to-1 ratio red to white. So we've lost the outcompete phenotype, which was exactly what we were looking for. So this one is the claim to fame. That is what is going to be the highlight of this paper. And so we were really excited to see that. She actually ended up doing like 6 replicates because she didn't believe it. She just kept doing more. She was like, she got it the first time. She's like, that's got to be a fluke. She didn't trust her undergrad. She was like, maybe she labeled them wrong. Like, it was one of those moments where 2 years, I think she got that result in like the beginning of April. She defended in April. So it was one of those moments, but pretty cool. So from this story, I basically told you that we did identify a bacterium from the termite gut that could outcompete termite pathogen. When we sequenced its genome, we found it had not one, but 2 type 6 secretion systems, and putative effectors associated with the type 6 secretion system are bactericidal. Finally, when we mutate those type 6 secretion systems, we see a rescue effect. So Alyssa is still working on this. She's got plans to finish the rest of those putative effectors. And then one of the objectives in the career grant I just submitted is about doing some of this in vivo. And so TBD on if we have funding to do that, but it'd be super exciting to see if we could inhibit type 6 secretion in vivo and see if we actually see the termites be more susceptible to pathogens. Okay, so we're back to our model. I told you about pathogens. Now I'm going to tell you about conspecifics. Okay, so we're going to change our hats. And this project is a part of a huge multi-institution grant funded by the NSF. So I want to highlight that. So I want to orient you a little bit into what a locust is. And I think colloquially we refer to this as a lot of different things. Cicadas are not locusts, right? Locusts are actually a group of short-horned grasshoppers. I say group because they are not monophyletic. So they're actually spread out across the Acritidae, and it's actually seemed to be lost a couple of times and then regained, which is pretty interesting. And locusts have both a physical and behavioral transformation from being a grasshopper to being what we would call a locust. So in this diagram, you can see on the left, this is Schistocerca cancellata, the South American locust, raised solitariously, so raised on its own, and then one that was raised in close contact with conspecifics. So this is the same species. All that's different is the rearing condition. And behaviorally, these solitarious animals kind of flee each other. They act like a typical grasshopper would, right? These do that. They form marching bands as nymphs. So they'll march across a field, completely decimating any plants that are in the way, basically defoliating everything in their wake. And then as adults, they have increased musculature that allows them to migrate long distances. In fact, they've migrated across the Atlantic Ocean multiple times based on their evolutionary history. So the South American locust and the Central American locust have different origins. They were different populations that migrated. So that's pretty wild. And so when we were writing this grant, every time I think about this, I always think about bacteria. And my colleagues are like, what are you talking about? So I had to convince them, no, bacteria have a place in this story, and I really want to understand what's going on in these guys' guts. So we know from other animal systems that gut bacteria can play a big role in things like serotonin production, other neurotransmitters or biogenic amines. But serotonin is one that seems to be a driver in locusts, so I was particularly interested in that. They're in close contact, those gut bacteria are in close contact to that thoracic ganglion. And so that one seems to be particularly important for things like long flight and marching. It drives that urge, that behavior. And then we know that this serotonin spike is associated with the process of gregarization, which is when you crowd solitarious individuals, you can actually trigger gregarious behavior. And if depending on where they are in their life history, you can actually get things like color change, depending on where they're at in their development. So pretty intense. So master student Bruna Pates basically scoured the literature and did a full review of all the very minimal locus microbiome research that was out there, trying to understand what the connection or potential connection between gut bacteria, this serotonin-driven behavioral change, and locusts as we know them. So Bruna was really excited because she found a link between things like metabolism and chronic carb hungriness being linked to serotonin deficiencies. We see this actually in humans, which I think is kind of interesting. This carb hungriness driving serotonin drops, linking obesity and depression, for instance. And then we even had a hypothesis about how this could actually be bacteria driving the bus. They want the locusts to aggregate because that facilitates transmission. And so she kind of put this together. This is her brainchild. She worked on this for literally 6 months, just tweaking this figure. But that was her non-thesis product. And I was pretty impressed with her ability. She was a neuroscientist by training, and she came to my lab kind of late in the game and did a really beautiful job. And so Alexis came in to do the like wet lab side of this idea. And so our hypothesis was that gut bacteria could be driving gregarization. And so as a part of this grant, we had the opportunity for Alexis to go spend a summer down at Texas A&M where they actually have a locust colony and do some manipulations in the lab. So what Alexis did was took locusts and raised them on three different treatments of wheatgrass. So in the lab, they have like a little cup of wheatgrass that they just hang out on and eat. And so she treated her locust wheatgrass with either triple sulfa, tetracycline, or water, and grew them up from hatchlings, so first instar hatchlings, all the way up to fourth instars, because that's how long she had. So they were kept in these little containers, and they were held in the room with the solitarius animals to keep them from getting extra olfactory and visual cues, because that's a thing that drives them. And then at the fourth instar, she marked them the day that they emerged so that she could have same age cohorts as she was going through. And she repeated this for a total of four replicates. So our idea here was that we were comparing normal locusts, those that have their microbiota, with locusts that had been perturbed, their microbiota had been perturbed in some way. And the locust gregarization community has this really cool behavioral assay where you have an arena. One end is the anti-stimulus, so there's nothing down there, it's just an empty box. One end is a stimulus chamber, which is full of conspecifics. And you basically drop a locust right in the middle and watch where it goes. Gregarious locusts tend to aggregate with their conspecifics, so they'll tend to spend more time down here where their conspecifics are. And solitarious locusts mostly just sit still. And sometimes kind of go to that anti-stimulus chamber if they go anywhere. So these are pictures of what it actually looks like. So this is the stimulus chamber. That little circle in the middle there is where you actually kind of push the locust up into the arena. And then this is the software tracking that locust as it moves. And I have to shout out Greg Sorn, who did all of the ethovision analysis. I am not a behavioral animal behavioralist at all. So shout out to him for analyzing, helping Alexis analyze her data. So the first thing that we looked at was velocity. So how fast are they moving around in the chamber? And we compared them to true breeding, multi-generation raised solitary animals of the same species compared to same thing, but only in crowding. So we have a baseline of what we think solitary animals should look like. And we have a baseline for what crowded animals should look like. And we're hoping that our crowded, raised, antibiotic-treated animals look different than we would expect. That would support our hypothesis. But that's not what we saw. Basically, all of the ones that were in our little buckets look intermediate. Okay. Well, that's kind of interesting. But unfortunately, that's not what doesn't support our hypothesis. So we wanted to look at moving time. Maybe they're not moving faster. They're just moving more. No. Okay, so they're not moving more or faster, but maybe they're moving farther, like they're hopping or something. Nope, they're not doing that either. So this is kind of a bust. The the thing that's really kind of unfortunate was that most of the behavior models that have been built, like algorithms, have been using fifth instars. And as I mentioned, Alexis used fourth instars, and that was just a constraint of the summer is only so many weeks. So we hope to repeat this experiment. We're still interested in that. It didn't support our hypothesis, but smoking gun that it's not there either. So we're still interested in that. So we had to think about another way to kind of get at Alexis's hypothesis that didn't require her to spend months down at College Station. And so we had the great fortune of some collaborators at Arizona State that had animals that they had collected in the field in Bolivia and had raised sister in the lab. And so we're like, okay, we've got two crowded conditions. Maybe we can have a better understanding about how rearing condition plays into gregarization. So there's a lot of things in the literature that kind of point fingers at particular bacteria, but they're all using lab reared animals. And so we were really wondering what the relevance ecologically was of those animals. So Alexis and Angel and Blessing all took animals from the field and from our collaborators at ASU and walked them through this protocol that they developed to work on ethanol preserved animals. DNA doesn't degrade in 100% ethanol. Bacteria die, so we can't culture them, but we can still look for their DNA signatures. And so they did this, and then we sent them for 16S amplicon sequencing just to get an idea of what the community composition of bacteria was. And so we're going to start you over here on the left. We have a Venn diagram showing that most of a large proportion of bacteria are shared regardless of rearing condition, but predictably, the wild animals have a bigger diversity of microbes. They are out in the wild. They have more things to come in contact with. Their environment is less sterile. Okay, that all tracks. And there are some things that are lab associated. They're getting colonized by things in the lab that don't exist in the wild. And interestingly though, when we break out the 10 most common genera, we see the same top 10. Okay, well, that's interesting. These bacteria are really associated with locusts, but you'll see that the abundances of those bacteria are different. And the one I want to draw your attention to is represented here in purple. And that's the one that had been pointed out as driving gregariousness in the lab. But I think it might actually just be lab associated. So at least in this species, the South American locust is chronically understudied. Most of the work that's been done on Schistocerca is on the desert locust in Africa. And so these guys have just less data. So maybe it's just not the case in this sample. So we tried to treat some crowded Schistocerca gregaria and didn't really see any effects on their behavior. But Alexis did find that lab-reared and wild-caught animals have distinct gut communities and that Weissella really seems to be lab-associated. And so now we're really trying to understand, we want to redo that first experiment. And we also have a bunch of wild-caught grasshoppers and locusts from plains of Texas. But we're also, I was just talking to somebody earlier about going into Mexico, down to Mexico in October, trying to collect some Central American locusts and get kind of round out the genus, get an understanding of what's going on across the genus, but focusing our efforts on wild caught animals. Okay, so we talked about pathogens, we talked about conspecifics, but now I need to talk about pesticides. So this was actually the very first project that I worked on. My first graduate student came in really interested in bioremediation. And so one thing that has kind of emerged in really the last 10 years is this idea of symbiote-mediated pesticide resistance. And so bioremediation kind of came into vogue around the turn of the century. We're isolating bacteria from the soil where pesticide drenches and things have been regularly applied. We're finding that they can use those as food. Not surprising, bacteria like to use anything as food. So it's got carbon, it's got nitrogen, it's food. And so it shouldn't have surprised us that some insects were associating with bacteria, sometimes facultatively, but sometimes in an obligate relationship, that these bacteria could break down pesticides that they were regularly encountering. And so this was really something that Allie was excited about, kind of the quintessential paper that came out in 2012 out of Japan, found that in a single generation, these bean bugs went from completely susceptible to phenanthrothione to completely resistant in a single field season. And so that's where that kind of pivoted our field to really looking at this. And that's what drove Allie to do her master's in this area. And she wrote a beautiful mini review, scouring the literature, finding all of the examples of insect-associated microbes that either circumstantially or directly were associated with a pesticide-resistant phenotype. And so she was working under the hypothesis that these bacteria are here all along. We're just selecting for them. We're selecting for them so that we see that phenotype. So she hypothesized that there are imidacloprid, so that's a pesticide used to treat termites, but there are tolerant bacteria to this pesticide in insecticide naive termites. They're there all along. We're only seeing them because we selected for them. And so back to good old methods, isolating a bunch of bacteria from the termite gut. Only this time, the assay that Allie wants to do is culture these bacteria with and without pesticide. And importantly, the media that she chose is nutrient poor. So it's got some really basic nitrogenous components, but no carbon. And so what she was interested in was which bacteria grow better when there's pesticide added compared to when there's not. She measured them at a couple of time points, and we're basically interested in where the bacteria grow better with the insecticide. That's all that says. And she had kind of like a multi-round regime where she started with 33 different isolates and kind of pared down from there. Oh yeah, I guessed, and that was right, 33. And so she basically from this found 7 isolates that were inherently tolerant, is what we're gonna call them, where they grew better when the pesticide was there than they did where there was no pesticide. And then we added one that did the same as kind of a control, a reference. So the next thing Allie wanted to do was, okay, so they're there. Can we select for it? Can we make this phenotype more exaggerated over time? And this would mimic something like constant exposure in the field. So she did an experiment where we subbed parent isolates of these inherently tolerant bacteria every 12 hours for 10 days. And then retested their tolerance to the pesticide after the selection regime, kind of comparing parent to daughter. And did that in the same assay that she did before. And so we had kind of two camps of bacteria. So we had 7 plus 1. And the first group did worse after selection. So the black bars are the parent, where we saw some kind of inherent tolerance. And the gray bars are after that 10 days, we expect to see if they're really supporting our hypothesis. We'd expect them to see them be even more tolerant. But those 4 aren't. They got worse. These guys, on the other hand, did much better. And you can see that in some cases, the biggest gains were made in the ones that barely squeaked by at first. So right now we're only looking at the difference between peptone water and the peptone water with imidacloprid. So these are all positives. They are growing, some more so than others. And Allie decided to focus on this bacterium because, so we did this in triplicate. She had 3 isolates of every bacterium that she put through this selection regime. And when she was doing this assay, this was one of her isolates at 4 hours. And she was like, I want to study that. And I was like, okay, that's the most, like statistically, that's not the one that is the most interesting. She's like, I want to study that. Because when she went back through her data, it went from not resistant, not resistant, not resistant, popped up and never lost it. And it happened all 3 times. So she was really interested in that. Who am I? I had startup at the time. Who am I? Go pursue your dreams. So the next question she wanted to ask, all along we've been working at the formulation rate, the recommended imidacloprid dosage for hormones. But realistically, in the environment, it accumulates. So the possibility that these bacteria are encountering increased rates is high. And so she was interested in that. So she grew these RF10 isolates in a range of imidacloprid concentrations from that 1x all the way up to 10x. And measured them every 24 hours and did this with the daughter isolates, but also the parent isolates to see if there was any kind of increased tolerance. Basically, nothing can grow in 10x, nothing. There was no difference. And there were no differences in some of these like discrete, I'm saving you from looking at bar graphs. All right, so there were no differences between parent and daughters at 48 hours for 1x or 2.5. And at 24 hours, the parents and daughters all performed equally well on 2.5. But where we got really excited was after the continuous culture at 48 hours, 5x, we see that all three daughters are actually doing way better than their parent. And so we wanted to know what was going on in these isolates. And so that's where Simantriana comes in. She actually did very similar. These were happening at the same time, mass spec analysis. And looked to see if there was anything that was kind of popping out in those jobs. Now, this is the first time that we'd ever done this. And these bacteria were particularly hard to get protein isolates out of. But what she saw was that we look at, we've got three reps of the parent and three reps of the daughter. It's actually the opposite of what we would have thought. The parent has something really abundant that the daughter doesn't have. And we thought maybe this is pesticide or something from that formulation is forming some kind of, clumping up proteins or something, but we ran empty and supernatant and couldn't find it. So we're like, okay, well, that's weird. What about in relationship to this kind of pesticide gradient? Bam. So it's pesticide concentration dependent. So the more pesticide, the parent upregulates whatever this is more, and the daughter doesn't. The daughter doesn't care how much pesticide is thrown at it. And it turns out to be a protein L isoaspartate O methyltransferase. I got nothing. You know something about those enzymes? Please talk to me. That's what it is. 100% of the hits are for that. We kind of left it there. They can do lots of things. If you want to go read about it, you can. We wave our hands. But I need to know what this bacterium is now, because clearly something is happening. Even though it was Allie's baby, she really wanted to study this one. And so we sequenced it and found out that it's a Chrysiobacterium, which I had never heard of because they reclassify bacteria all the time. But it actually is one that we find again and again associated with bioremediation, mostly in soils, but not in insects. And so that was kind of exciting that it was something that maybe we should have expected, lots of Chrysiobacteria. And I'm going to skip this. It's got some detox enzymes. It's not really remarkable genomically. That's what I just told you. But you can have insecticide tolerant bacteria in a completely naive host. I think that that should give us pause from a conservation standpoint, from a pest management standpoint. So I think that's interesting. Not what we expected. Not what I expected. Definitely what Allie expected. I was like, yeah, master's is the time to learn the hard way. And then she proved me wrong. So I'm just going to rehash really quickly the stories that I told you. First, we looked at these three different interactions between hosts, microbes, and different biotic and abiotic environmental components, and found that, yes, symbionts can have a protein arsenal at their disposal to outcompete putative pathogens or potential pathogens for their host. And we found that to be the type 6 secretion system in this study. We also looked at some conspecific behavior related to the gut microbiome of locusts, and didn't find anything associated with gregarization, but we do see a signature for labbered animals, which should guide us going forward in how we study the behavior of these animals, especially when testing that hypothesis. And then we did find this cool Chrysobacterium that has this weird proteinomethyltransferase that I don't know what it's doing. So if you do a lot of HPLC, maybe we should talk. And so with that, I'm going to shout out all my funding again, and I'm happy to take questions.
Thank you. Great talk. I was wondering, I think I maybe mentioned, I missed it, in your competition essays in the first story, what was the like medium in the petri dish? And presumably whatever it was that it's not the same as the guts of termite necessarily. So is it realistic or interesting to compete them like in the in the bug? Can you like feed them the putative protective bug, or does it help fish?
Yeah, so that's a great question. The medium that we used was just LB, so just basic. And is that mimicking what the termite gut is like? Absolutely not, right? It's a very nitrogen poor environment. But because it's happening in the gut, we don't actually have like a published kind of an analog. If it was in the hemolymph or something, we could use Grace's medium or something like that, but we don't. We want to do in vivo studies. That's actually one of the things in my career grant and that Alyssa is really hoping to do, kind of force feeding cocktails and then inhibiting type 6 and looking at all of those things. So we know that these bacteria are there. We've done some quantitative PCR with some specific primer. We know that they're there. We want to look at like their dynamic titer throughout development and in different environmental situations. But yeah, that's super relevant. LB is obviously not the same as a termite gut, but exciting nonetheless.
Hey, thanks for that wonderful talk. Yeah. I kind of had a question about sort of the how widespread phylogenetically that gregarization behavior is, because I guess I'm finding it hard to understand why we might attribute that behavior to gut bacteria as opposed to some sort of underlying genomic basis, just because it's so deep and conserved after how many tens of millions of years of evolution across several continents. Why would we attribute it to presumably quite different gut bacteria on different continents?
Yeah, no, that's a great question. So I think what's missing here is context. So our team is studying this phenomenon from all different angles. So we've got folks that are studying the genomes. We have a 6-genome project that we're annotating right now across Schistocerca. Let me answer your first question first. Gregarization is spread out over, I think, 6 genera in Acritidae, and they're not closely related. Schistocerca is the genus that has the most. And importantly, the oldest lineage, Schistocerca gregaria, is gregarizing, and then it loses and gains it kind of along the way. So that's why we chose Schistocerca. There are people looking at genomics. We're looking at epigenomics. We're looking at tissue-specific transcriptomics, single cell, all kinds of things. My shtick is bacteria. And so I think from my perspective, I don't think necessarily that bacteria are the sole driver. I think it's an interaction. Right? It's a genes by environment thing. And in this case, the bacteria are an environmental thing. And so we know that even though we have similar genomes, we don't all respond to things like serotonin identically. And so it could be that kind of interaction. That's where my hypothesis lies. I just didn't get into the weeds because I'm used to talking to undergrads.
Yeah, again, great talk. I thought the locus graphical stuff is fascinating. I mean, it's really obviously the fact you can flexibly switch between the two different forms.
Insane.
Those kind of questions. I was just curious, like, obviously, you would tend to, like, with like social insects, like ants and termites, for example, sure. They do these kind of like global access, like kind of transmission opportunities. I was wondering in termites, the locus, after you can actually imagine if we're expecting there to be some sort of transmission benefit for being experienced, if there's low opportunities in that system, like just why, like where would they be acquiring the bacteria? And on that, like if you were to say, like look at those marching bands in the wild, if you would expect within a given marching band to be like based on that hypothesis, there would be like a more homogenized gut microbiome between them and Martian bats.
That is super interesting. So first point, they do cannibalize each other, and you have to consider that a lot of our hypothesis about one of the drivers to gregarization is food insecurity. Patchiness in the environment seems to be a driver. The nutrient composition of the plants in that ecosystem seems to be a driver, phosphorus to nitrogen ratios, things like that. So there's a nutritional component. And so there have been some like cannibalism hypotheses. And so that is one mode of transmission, but they also will eat each other's poop. They poop on plants, they eat it, they do not care. So while they're not doing active like grooming like a termite would, they're still participating in coprophagy and cannibalism and things like that. So, and when they die, they also liquefy and things like that. So there's methods for that. And I already forgot the part of your question.
So we're like within a given market.
Oh, yeah. Yes. So we think that that precursor would have to happen before they're marching. So it has to be something in that natal environment that's driving it. And so, yeah, I think to our colleague's point, it's not the only driver. I think the thing that's really frustrating about locusts is there are tactile, olfactory, visual, all kinds of cues that have to get them to this threshold. And it's species specific. Sometimes you tickle their antennae, sometimes you rub their hind legs. Like, it's very elaborate. And so there have to be, it's about getting to that threshold, and maybe the mode doesn't matter.
Hey, I was wondering what the sort of relative frequency is of the gain of pesticide resistance via associated microbes versus inherent to the insect's genome. I work in agricultural fields, and I find it horrifying.
Yeah.
That I work with herbicides, but even the pesticides.
Yeah, it'll be bad. It's all scary. I understand. Yeah. So, I think the problem is that we have underestimated the microbes. And so we've got a lot of examples of what we thought were host-driven resistance that may have been like, again, a genes by environment kinds of things. So I'm actually writing a review right now, so I can send it to Kaylee and y'all can have it. But where we see examples of the composition of the microbes actually driving gene expression. And in some cases, so there's a really cool paper out of Mike Scharf's lab at Purdue, he's now at Florida, where they found that actually downregulation of cytochrome oxidase P450s resulted in a resistant phenotype. And that's counterintuitive because those are detox enzymes and it seems to be microbially driven. And so that kind of stuff is where I'm really interested. And we barely started talking about this like microbe toxicology kind of interaction. And so does it happen? Yes. Have we underestimated it? Absolutely. Is it the only way? Absolutely not, right? We've got lots of evidence that there can be mutations, point mutations and things like that lead to resistance, but it's something that we haven't been considering in the way that we should. That's, yeah, now you just run my review. Yeah.
Okay, let's thank Dr. Peterson again for joining us. If you have more questions. This across the hall. And Dr. Peterson is just going to stick around for a little while. Yeah. Thank you.